If you ever tried to connect to a remote server, you are probably already familiar with Secure Shell Protocol, or SSH in short. It's a secure, encrypted connection between your local machine, like your laptop or your PC, and the remote server that you want to access. This connection, this SSH connection, works on port 22, and it's something that either you have to configure yourself, or you ask your admin at work to configure it for you, so you can access that remote server from home or from other remote location. But in fact, once you have that connection configured on port 22, you can also use it for SSH tunneling, which is a method to access other applications running on other ports on that remote server. Let's say that remote server is a Windows server and you want to use VNC or RDP protocol to connect to it. You don't have to ask your admin again to grant you access to that server on port 3389. As that's the port for RDP connection. You can already connect to it by using that SSH tunneling method. You can hide that traffic on different port like 3389 inside the SSH tunnel. And this way you can easily and securely use RDP connection and have that graphical user interface. Because clear RDP connection is not even considered secure. Same with other traffic, like maybe you are building a website at work and that website is running there locally on the server, but you can't access it because port 80, which is default port for HTTP traffic, is blocked. And if you ask your administrator to open that port for you, that request will most probably be rejected anyways. But again, if you already have access to that server via SSH on port 22, you can hide that traffic on port 80 to your web server inside that SSH tunnel. And that tunnel will be run and will be seen as connection on port 22 from outside. And any other port will be hidden inside. So I created a small environment today to show how we can configure and test that SSH tunneling method. We will use a laptop that I have at home, and I have built two servers, like remote servers, in AWS cloud. One of these servers has public IP address, the other one doesn't have public IP address, it only has private IP address, and we will have to tunnel through that first server with public IP address. So from the beginning, we will first create the basic SSH connection to server 1 with public IP. We will then create SSH tunnel to reach a website on port 80 on that server, because there is like a Nginx running on it and it acts as a little web server. And we will then extend that SSH tunnel even further. We will go through that first server, so server 1 will only act as a jump host or bastion, so called, and we will terminate the SSH tunnel on servers to private IP address. And we will then access a different website that is running on that server too, because I also installed Nginx there, and it's slightly different website, slightly different version of website on that server. I will then quickly show you how you can extend that connection even further. Okay, so let's start from establishing basic SSH connection between my laptop and server 1. So let's start from my laptop. This is Ubuntu system running on my macOS. And doesn't really matter what system operating system you have there, any system will do. We just have to create something called SSH keeper. And the command to create it is ssh-keygen. I'll press enter. It will show you, it will create public private RSA keeper. So let's just press enter, 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 enter. That's it. That keeper has been created. And you can see it's been saved in home parallels.ssh. ID RSA is private key. And ID RSA pub is public key. So where are we now? We are in home parallels, so I have to go into .ssh. And if I run lsli, I will see that keeper. And this is the key we are interested in, the public key. So I can do cat ID RSA.pub. And this is the portion we will have to copy. Let's copy it. We will have to copy to remote server so we can access it from this laptop. So now these are my two servers. This one we will use later on. Let's concentrate on server 1 for the time being. I have to first create a user on this server. And it doesn't really matter what you call that user. It doesn't have to match the laptop user, you know. You can call it, let's call it Marek. Sudo add user Marek is the command that I need. So we will create a user Marek. I will create password as well. But it's not the password that we will use really, we will use that public SSH key to log in. So now I can switch to that user, to that newly created user. I will use sudo su-marek command. I am now logged on as Marek. I switched to user Marek. and we have to create a new folder called .ssh. So the command is make dir.ssh. I have to now change permissions for that folder. The command is change mod 700.ssh. Now we can cd to that folder, and we have to touch new file here. We have to create new file, and it has to be called authorized keys. So it's touch authorized underscore keys. We have to change permissions for that file as well. We have to use change mod 600 authorized keys. And now we can use a text editor like Vim, Nano, whatever, to paste our public key from the laptop to this server, to that file. I will use Vim authorized keys. And let's paste it here. That's my public key I copied from my laptop. So now it's :wq, enter. And now I should be able to SSH from my laptop to this remote server. But I have to know a public IP of this remote server. I can use, for example, curl ifconfig me command to see the public IP of my server. So this is it. This is public IP of this server. I will copy it. If I go back to my laptop, and if I use the user I created on remote server, I should be able to SSH. So it's SSH, Marek, at, and the IP of that server. Let's press enter. If you SSH for the first time, this is the question that will be asked. If you are really sure you know what you are connecting to. And yes, I am sure. Yes. And now we are logged in as Marek at server 1 from this laptop. So being on this remote server, I can also use command like curl localhost on port 80. And this is actually response from the Nginx. So I've got website running on this server, on server 1. And you can see it's, you know, it's not like what you see in the browser usually, but this is just HTML code for this website. And you can see this is response from server 1. That's what we are supposed to see in our browser. But the problem is, I am unable to reach that website from outside, from any other location, because port 80 is not allowed to that server. I can only view it when I am directly on this server and when I call localhost. That means I can only locally reach it. Just to show you something, if I exit now, we are now back on our laptop. If I run curl to that public IP and port 80, it will get me nowhere. This connection is prohibited, it's being filtered. But the thing is, even let's control C, let's go to the server. Even if I copy that command and run it directly on the server, I am still unable to reach it. Why? Because this public IP is actually the one that filters this traffic. So let me control C. I have to use localhost. Now I get the response. I could also try something like it's basically the same thing. 127.0.0.1 is localhost. Because if you check hosts file, shows you that basically it's the same thing. All right, but let's clear that again. What I can do now, I can create that SSH tunnel, which from outside will look like secure and encrypted SSH connection. And inside that SSH tunnel, I will have another type of traffic. And in my case, it will be HTTP traffic, but you can hide any traffic you want on any port. And we will run this traffic inside our SSH tunnel. So how do I do that? The command I need is still the SSH command. So that was the one that took us to server 1 from our laptop. But we will add some options to hide this HTTP traffic and run it inside the SSH tunnel. And there, dash N, capital N. I will talk about it in a minute, but let's first create full command. Then dash L, it's again capital L. Then IP address or domain and the port I want to listen on here locally on this laptop. And let's say it will be localhost on port 8888, separated by colons, and then colon again, and the remote location. So this is what we tried to run to get the output of the Nginx web server. So it was localhost on port 80. So first portion is related to here to my laptop, and second portion is related to that remote server. I know it's a bit complicated, but basically that dash n argument means do not execute a remote command. We want to use this to forward the port. Basically, we want to use it for that SSH tunneling. And dash l It's basically saying that we are talking about local port 8888 here on localhost that we'll be listening on. And whatever we push to that port will go to the remote location to the other side, but on the other side it will be received and run as port 80. This way we can manage all local ports and the remote receiving ports on the remote server. You can use any combination that you like. Okay, let's run it. Let's just click enter. Looks like nothing is happening, yes? But now, if I go to my browser and I go to localhost on port 8888, it should take me from this laptop to remote location to that web server. Let's see. As you can see, we have a response. Welcome to Nginx. This response is from server 1. That means the tunneling works as expected. And if I control C here, this tunnel is now terminated. And just wanted to add, we can get rid of that first localhost, because that's what you usually want to do anyways. You want to run it here on localhost, not anywhere else. So that's kind of like a default and we can get rid of it. So if you go back, if we create the tunnel again, but we get rid of this first localhost, this will work fine. And then, for example, the second localhost is for remote location, but we can replace it for whatever is working for us on that remote server. Like we know 127.0.0.1 was working because it's basically equivalent of localhost. This is domain name for this IP address. So if I run it now, it still should work. Let's try maybe in private window just to make sure it's completely new connection. As you can see, it still works fine. Okay, let's control C. And I hope that makes sense. Every time I enter that localhost 8888, like I did here, when the tunnel is on, it will simply go to remote location to the application that currently listens on port 80 on the remote server. So I hope that portion is clear now. And now let's go a step further and create an SSH tunnel that will go through jump host or bastion. I mean server 1, because server 1 has that public IP address. This address, it can act as a bastion or jump host, so we can get to server number 2, which doesn't have public IP address. So the only way to reach it is via server 1. So to do that, let's first establish basic SSH connection to server 2. But maybe let's use another user. So we've got Parallels on laptop, we've got Marek on server 1, and on server 2, maybe let's create something completely different, like Katie maybe. The command is sudo add user Katie, password, we switch to that new user, sudo su dash Katie. By the way, that dash means also that you will land automatically in home directory of that user. So let's press enter. In that home directory, we will create a new folder .ssh. We will change permissions again. Oops, sorry. We will cd into that folder, touch authorized keys, change permissions for that file. And now we will have to paste that public key. Colon WQ, that's it. And now we will try to connect to that server 2, going through server 1 and use user Marek on server 1 and Katie on server 2. Let's check the SSH manual first. And we can see dash A enables forwarding of connections. That's what we will need for this occasion. And if we go further, we can see dash J connect to the target host by first making an SSH connection to the jump host. That's also what we need. All right, let's control C or Q, sorry. Let's clear that. So the command I need is SSH dash A dash J. We are jumping through the box. We first provide details for the jump box for our bastion, and it was Marek at, what was it? This IP of server 1, and then username and IP of server 2. Server 2, IP address. That's the IP. That's what we need. If I press enter, because it's first time I connect to server 2, it will ask me the same question if I know exactly what I'm connecting to. Yes, I know what it is. And we can see we landed as Katie at server 2. And that's fine, we can SSH, but we can create tunnel through that jump host. In fact, it's a very similar process. Let's exit, let's clear, let's see that previous command we used. Now we still have to use that dash n. We first put the username and IP of the destination server, so it's actually that KT that has to go first. Oh, sorry, I must stop something again. So we can remove it from the end. Then I'm saying dash j, we are jumping through that host, which is our server 1, and then again localhost and port here on local machine on my laptop, colon again localhost, and then the remote port. And as we remember, we can get rid of that first localhost, it's not necessary, it's default, so we can just leave it out. That's the command we need. Let's press enter now. Again, looks like nothing happens, but now let's open new private window. We go to localhost again on port 8888. Whoops, sorry, what's that? Oh, my mistake, sorry. I missed one thing, pretty important one, and you might even know what it was. It was dash L here, dash L we had previously. Now if I run it again, let me connect again. Now we have response from server 2 this time. What I can also do, I can open another terminal session. For example, I can curl to localhost 8888. This is run on my laptop, but it will still take me to server 2, to Nginx on server 2. Because every time I push something to that port, it will go through the tunnel to the other server. Let's control C. Hope that makes sense. Now I just wanted to talk about this localhost. We can use this portion of command different way. If we had, for example, a database server or any other server that runs even further, so I mean it's behind that server 2, but it's accessible from server 2, we could use the same command that still terminates SSH tunnel on server 2, I mean like this one, but instead of running localhost 80, we can put IP address here of the database server and use port that will connect us to the database server. I mean something like, something like that. And I'm not going to build yet another server, but I just wanted to show you that it's possible to do it if you want to reach something even further in your network. And generally, you know, SSH is one of those things that when you start learning it, you only find out there is more and more to learn about it. And that's all I wanted to show you today. So thank you for watching and see you next time.